I don't want to go much longer, and I apologize for the being late 5 minutes, but we're at another meeting. First item on the agenda is the acceptance of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Selectman Danahy is attending personal business and won't be with us tonight. Is there a walk-in period? There is none. For the first time in my life, I was hoping there was some. Al?
I could be.
Go ahead.
It's pretty funny.
I have two quick topics that will be well within the 5 minute requirement. First one is that on Monday, October 12th, the intersection of Front Street, Edward Foster Road, First Parish Road, and Kent Street will become a four-way stop. It's currently a three-way stop in front of St. Mary's. Become a four-way stop. It will be announced on the various media we have for announcing things, such as the website, Channel 10. Perhaps the mayor will have an article about it, alerting people. We will also have a flashing signboard placed just before the Scituate Bridge, alerting traffic coming out of Front Street that there will be a new stop sign there. This is at the request of numerous requests of residents, the police, and through traffic observation is the much safer intersection with a four-way stop instead of a three-way stop.
Thank you.
The second thing I would mention is that the special event at the transfer station went primo, very well. It was fun to see a lot of smiling faces bringing in carloads of children's toys and furniture. It was also fun to see those same people leaving with carloads of children's toys and furniture. So the net items left at the transfer station were about $70 worth of material to be hauled away.
That's all?
Not much.
Wonderful.
Wow.
That's great.
So it was well done. We'll probably do it again in another year.
Do you, I'm just on that subject, not to delay it, but do you have plans to do any other special events, like I noticed sporting equipment, for example?
I believe that the PTO is doing a sporting equipment one this fall, but we are open to that idea, Joe, as
okay.
Any other kind of special events. We are also looking at improvements we can do. We think that will make the Take It or Leave It a happier and healthier place for people who want to bring things in. We had a lot of opportunity to talk to people who were bringing in toys and other items and to talk with them about what's the best way to make this thing work a little more smoothly at the Take It or Leave It, and I'll come back with some ideas on that
Great.
When we're ready to go.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Thank
you.
The next item on the agenda is a very pleasant one. It's an opportunity to meet our new superintendent of schools, Dr. Susan Martin. Susan, if you come up and say hello.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, thank you for coming.
Good seeing you.
Tony again.
Yeah, I'm Rick.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Oh, it's nice to meet you.
Sean,
nice to meet you.
You.
Before you start, Susan, we'd just like to take this opportunity as a board to welcome you to Scituate and certainly look forward to working with you, not only this year here, but in coming years going forward. So,
well, Chairman Norton, you actually echoed my comments to the board. Thank you very much for inviting me this evening. I look forward to working with you this year in the coming years. It was an exciting opportunity. I've already started July 1st. I've had a wonderful entering 4 months now, and it's been great. And I particularly enjoy working with our new town administrator as well. So I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have about the school department, and I look forward to working with you.
I think those questions will probably come.
I'm sure they will. Do they have numbers attached to them? I heard about this formula.
As we go through the process, I personally don't have one other than welcome you and thank you
so
much for coming and wishing
them.
I don't know. I don't want to stop anyone else from the board.
No, I've been to a number of school committee meetings, and I think you're doing a great job up there. And I think the whole school committee is moving forward. So I'm really pleased with the progress.
Thank you, Tony. I strongly believe in a very good partnership and collaborative relationship between the town and the school. So, and I think we're off to a good start.
And I think Trish can, I know that you two have met on a number
yes.
of times. And,
mm-hmm. and we continue to meet on a weekly basis. Thursdays at 2.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Jane Lopato. Discussion on municipal lien certificate fee increase. Jane, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Fine, thank you.
I had proposed an increase of the fee from the current $25 fee structure to $50. When I had first come here, my staff had already increased it to $50, but the formal procedure had never been done. So I put the fee back to $25 to correct that. Many of the surrounding communities, at Tricia's request, I had my staff do some phone calling around. And we still, to this day, even though I've been here almost 3 years, get $50 checks by mistake. So rather than to return them and collect $25, I'd like to keep the $50. And so I'm asking that the board, under that chapter and section of Mass General Laws that was passed in 2007, increase the fee to the $50.
Rick Murray.
Is $50 enough? I mean, should it be higher?
I don't know any place that charges more than 50, so I'd be hesitant
Perfect.
To do
okay.
that.
Excellent.
So, but thank you.
No, thank you.
Jane, can you just explain in layman's terms what this, when someone would be charged this $50?
Sure.
So anyone that's watching?
I'll tell you when it should be charged. It often isn't always done, but typically it should be done when there's a sale of property, and it's a document that has the outstanding taxes. It usually has 3 years of taxes, including the current year, and then that gets filed by the closing attorney, sometimes title companies require them. They require them when there's a foreclosure. They do them when they should be doing them when there's a refinance, and they are recorded at the Registry of Deeds or Land Court, whichever is appropriate. I find it's a problem sometimes because sometimes firms doing refinances don't require them, and they should, because you never know if I've put them in tax title or there's delinquent taxes. So it also works as a collection tool for me and my office, and we send little notes. Right now I'm getting ready to do the FY09 tax taking, so if we see that outstanding on the liens I'm signing, we put a note to call for payoff. So
this is not a fee that's really going to be assessed to any citizen, other than it's on that long list of things when you do a mortgage.
Right.
One of those line items is $50 fee for blah, blah, blah.
The law firms probably charge more than $25. Right. We charge them. But on occasion, residents do come in. Sometimes it's just them running an errand to facilitate a closing or something. But 99% of the time, it's the law firms or the title companies that are doing it.
Thank you. It's usually buried in the closing costs. The reason why I asked if it was high enough is because I just refied a couple months ago, and I went back and looked, and it was 75, and I dug a little further, and it's because the law firm took 25
yep.
to do it, and then there was a $50 for it. So that's why I was asking.
Motion to refer no further.
Will the Board of Selectmen vote to increase the municipal lien certificate fee to $50 effective November 1st, 2009, per the recommendation of the Treasurer Collector?
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you. Number five, one-day wine and malt beverage license for St. Mary's Parish Center. Just in time. Good timing. Perfect timing. This is for Joshua's run, right? Yeah. There we go. Very briefly, just for advertising purposes more than anything else, we just explain what Joshua's Run is?
Joshua's Run is in its 13th year. I don't need to speak into this, Josh. It's in its 13th year. It's a road race in town. And we have an art auction the weekend before. Andrea's art auction that was attached to the race. It's still attached to the race, but it's its own event now this year. So it's the weekend before. And all the proceeds from both events go to pediatric oncology research at the Dana-Farber into a fund set up by the Gaziano family, Andrea Gaziano's Memorial Fund. That's what that's all about.
We know of it well. And motion? I'll just
move that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a one-day wine and malt beverage license to Joshua's Run, Andrea's Auction, for the fundraiser to be held at St. Mary's Parish Center, 1 Kent Street, on Saturday, October 17th, from 7:30 to 11 p.m.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous. While you're up there.
So that's for the first week.
That's for the first.
That's for the 17th.
Is the art show the first weekend, the 17th?
Yes.
Right. And that was a huge success last year, I heard.
Yeah.
Right. That was your first liquor license. Now
the second one is post-race. So I already talked about the race. Yeah. So it's after the race at the post-race festivities.
Okay.
At St. Mary's Parish Center again.
Yep.
Would you like a motion?
I'd love a motion.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a one-day wine and malt beverages license to Joshua's Run, Esther Blacker, for a fundraiser to benefit the Jimmy Fund to be held at St. Mary's Parish Center, 1 Kent Street, on Saturday, October 24th, 2009, from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m.
Second.
Before we vote, just would you give your names just for the TV cameras, and Kim, please.
Oh, the cameras here. Yes, Esther Blacker.
Yep.
Mary Ellen Gazian.
Just a question. Mary, where do they get the art? Is it from local artists that donate it?
It is local artists, cool. Mostly local. We have some people from New York, some from Connecticut, but it's mostly local artists. We have almost 50 pieces that we'll be auctioning off, so we'd love to have you come by. It's a great event.
Good.
Great. Excellent.
Esther, if someone wants to participate in this, how do they get involved? Is there a website, or is there a...
There's Joshua's Run website, www.joshuasrun.com. And the Andrea's Art Auction, anybody can show up to the art auction at 7:30 at the Parish Center. And the race, you can register online at active.com or just go right to the website. And
there's, isn't there a walking?
There's a two-mile, I'm sorry, yes. There's a kids' fun run at 8:30, a two-mile fun run walk at 9, and a five-mile cliff challenge at 10 o'clock. And then post-race, there's, a complimentary food and beverage and music. Matt Brown will be there this year providing live music. And there'll be live music also at Andrea's Art Auction. That'll be Skip Toomey and Friends. So it's great.
Great.
Things are looking good so far.
It's also on Facebook.
Right. Both we're not on Twitter yet, but that's coming.
It's coming.
As always, good luck.
Great luck.
Good luck. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Agenda item number 7. Kevin?
Excuse me, we need a vote on that.
We need a vote, I'm sorry. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you, Ken.
Hey, Kevin.
Good evening, Kevin.
Kevin, how are you tonight?
Very good. And yourself?
I'm fine, thank you.
The first item I brought up would be to change the fees and bonding requirements in the street opening permit process. Looking to initiate a fee system for the street openings of $125 to handle the administrative and the inspection work associated with that.
Joe?
That's number.
John?
I had a chance to talk to Al and Kevin a little while ago. When I was looking over the agenda earlier, I had contacted a local contractor here in town just to get his feeling on it. I thought we had these things in place from the poor backfilling job on Beaver Dam Road by Jericho Road with Rick, and I explained to Kevin, but this is great to see that it's more solid and concrete.
Mm-hmm. Kevin, can you just go over the fee?
I was going to propose we double it. $10,000. Not to discourage smaller contractors from working, but I just don't know how far $5,000 will go. On a single home water hookup, it's fine. But if you have to excavate a trench, a couple hundred feet away, and hopefully this doesn't come into
effect. Why don't we do this? Why don't we have a discussion on the general motion?
Okay, that's fine.
And then when it comes time to make a motion, if you feel like inserting $10,000 instead of $5,000, go ahead. Tony,
Rick actually answered my question. I didn't see that the revised number. I was looking at the
originally I'd done a square footage price, but we have problems with the gas company and utility companies with that. So I figured a standard fee of $125, similar to what Hingham does, would be more acceptable.
So this is a $125 fee to get a permit to open up the road.
Get a permit to open up a road.
And you have to have a bond for $5,000 so that if you don't...
And you have to get a bond, performance bond, that over that year time, if that trench unravels and you're non-responsive and won't repair it, that we can go after that bond and collect the money for the repairs and hire somebody else to do that work.
And what does somebody have to do right now?
Fill out a permit and application and...
So there's no fee?
There's no fee.
And there's no bond?
There's no bonding requirements.
Great. You sort of answered the first part of my question. As I asked this earlier of Ms. Lopardo, I said, is this fee enough? And for the $125, it clearly seems enough because the information you provide us is right in line with Hingham and some of the other towns, so that's great. But the $5,000, where did the $5,000 come from versus should it be more or less? Or?
Well, I mean, I'm all for more. I came up with $5,000, just past experience. I've seen $5,000 bonds posted. Marshfield requires a $5,000 bond.
Okay.
You know, that's basically where
I came up.
Sure.
Okay. Sean has a $1,000 number, so.
It's not.
I just wanted to make sure I brought it up as well because I had the same question.
Yep.
It's a performance bond, and if you're in business, it's nothing. You know, performance bond for that amount is nothing.
So, but what sort of repair can $5,000 do if the, you know, I guess it all, as I think Sean was saying, it depends on the size of the job.
Exactly. It depends on the size of the job. If it goes across the roadway and you have a police detail, it could be more money. So I don't think $10,000 is out of line either.
Okay. Further discussion?
I don't know if Al has any input on this as well or no.
Further discussion? If not, a motion.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to allow the Engineering Division of the Department of Public Works to charge a fee of $125, where applicable and permissible, for street opening permits and to require a bond of $10,000 posted by any contractor opening a street in the town of Scituate.
So you said $10,000.
I did.
Just want to make sure.
Yeah, yep. I did. If that's agree, I, you
know. Is the motion?
Second.
And a second. Discussion.
Is $10,000 be perceived as punitive or unworkable from your perspective, Kevin?
It would vary depending on the size of the trench. I mean, if somebody came out and did a little 4x4 and they pulled a $10,000, you know, bond for it, but if there's no major cost differential, I don't see the difference from $5,000 to $10,000. I think that's reasonable.
Great. Thanks.
Discussion from the floor, seeing none. All in favor of Sean's motion, signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Unanimous.
Thank you.
What else?
The second item I had was the establishment of a fee for excavation on a moratorium street.
Yep.
Currently, what I've looked through, there's nothing in the bylaws. But I did find at one point that we require a contract to use flowable fill on moratorium streets, which are streets that have been paved after that five-year period. My request here is if somebody does need to do work in a street, for example, change a, add a gas service or do a new water service or something to that effect, or say there's a new home going in and they want to run a new water service on a freshly paved street, that they'd be required to pay a $5,000 fee associated with working, and that would, you know, try to limit the amount of work done on a moratorium street.
Discussion? Rick?
Tony, you want you had your hand up first. You want to do it?
That's my question.
Rick?
All right. I understand, so if it's an emergency, it gets waived. But
you say if the gas company has a leak, I don't want them worrying about a $5,000 fee. I want them to...
Yeah. Okay. What if it's the phone company or something else like that, and it's their fault, not the resident's fault? Is the phone company
would pay? Phone company's up overhead. The majority of that's overhead.
Majority, but not all of them.
I can't think of any. Trying to think of underground duct banks in town. I think it in North Scituate there might be one underground duct bank.
Okay.
And a run that goes up along Country Way.
But overall, my question is, and I'll defer to you obviously on the knowledge, but if there are situations where it's not the homeowner's fault, yet it is not an emergency, then that gets charged to the company or whatever it
and
might be.
And whoever's pulling the permit, that'd be between them and the homeowner, would be required to pay the $5,000.
Okay.
My main concern is if the gas company suspects they have a leak and comes to us and says we need an emergency permit, we got to go in there. I don't want them waiting around.
Absolutely.
For us,
so. Absolutely. Yep, great.
I'm worrying about a $5,000.
Yeah. And 5,000, my sort of similar question, is that, how'd you come up with that, and is that scale with other towns? There's a little bit of work here, a little background here you said about Hingham does not allow excavation unless it's an emergency. They just don't allow it at all.
Correct. They don't allow it at all. You know, we used it in Lexington, there was a fee attached with it, and I believe the fee was $5,000.
Okay.
And the reason is if somebody does want to go out there and say somebody is putting a house in, it's kind of hard to just deny completely, not
sure.
allowing them to do services
yeah.
or any other work to that effect.
Yeah, I agree.
But, you know, they should pay a penalty or try to, you know, try to discourage the use of excavating in the roadway under that effect.
Certainly it'll give people a little bit of a pause before they just sort of do it willy-nilly.
Yeah, because if you're going to switch over to save, say, $100 a year in a, you know, from oil to gas, you would think twice about it, you know, if you had
right.
a $5,000 fee that was associated with it.
Right. Excellent. Thank you.
So.
You know, we
who would ever do that?
Thank you, Rick.
There you go.
We had a policy. At least I thought we had a policy.
We did. Same thing. We talked to Rick about it.
You couldn't do it at all.
Right.
But the problem is that, you know, I guess the policy was just that, a policy, and it was broken more often than not, because we spoke numerous over the years after we're seeing a street put in and then
yeah.
a hole dug up 2 weeks later, and we had, as I said, many conversations saying no more, but maybe this will be put in.
I didn't see anything looking through.
Yeah, there probably was nothing. It probably was nothing written down. This maybe you'll put some teeth in it.
That's what I was hoping for. At least
yeah. sounds great.
Know, so
yeah.
that I can, you know, I'd hate to see Border Street get dug up after putting all the effort into.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, there's, you know, I'd like a little backup. You know, shooting down a permit if something came in.
Yep.
Absolutely.
And how often does it actually happen? Infrequently? I mean, I know occasionally. I just know it's a, you know, pain in the neck when it does happen, but it doesn't happen all that often.
Ruins a day, all it has to happen is once.
Yeah.
When you have a brand new street, somebody's digging it up the next day.
And they would still have to give the bond and make sure that it got repaired at the
exactly.
same quality.
Yeah. And just as a point of interest, the gas company's not really subject to the, you know, the bonding requirements always, because they're subject to the Department of Public Utilities. So they're actually under some more stringent standards than what's required by your average contractor.
Okay, and it's 5 years. If the street's less than 5 years old, then you have to pay the fee.
Less than 5 years old, you'd have to pay that fee.
Okay.
That's all repaved streets, also. Repaved.
If we ground down a street and repaved over that, that'd be considered a moratorium street.
For example, the streets that were redone because of the sewer.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, if you ground and overlay the street, it'd be considered a moratorium street.
I mean, here we have areas, Cliffs, Greenbush, soon to down Hadley, which are, you know, relatively nicely paved and look nice. And if we don't put something in place, they'll look like they've been there for 100 years.
We just don't want to have to go, you know, it's not too often we can do it, like Greenfield Lane. It's wonderful. So you'd
yep.
hate to have it dug up.
Yeah.
One quick question: is the definition of a moratorium street somewhere in our bylaws or somewhere in, so there's never going to be a debate over?
It's referenced in the bylaws.
Okay.
Motion,
please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote a fee of $5,000 to open a street that is under the moratorium 5 year period.
Second.
Further discussion from the floor? On the board, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous. Thank you.
Well done.
Number
well done,
nine
Good
is
job.
To open and close the special town meeting warrant. What we will do tonight is open the warrant, close the warrant at the end of tonight's meeting, and vote to insert, I believe there was is it five articles, Fisher?
Six
articles. Move to insert six articles into the warrant for town meeting. So we'll start off with number nine, and this is simply a vote to open the warrant at the current time and then close it at the end of the meeting. So,
Go ahead.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to open the November 2nd, 2009 special town meeting warrant at 7:29 p.m. and that the said warrant will close at the adjournment of tonight's meeting.
Second.
Need a second. Motion's been made, seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Unanimous. The next item, agenda item number 10, is a discussion on the special town meeting articles.
Just take the one I'm giving you.
Throw the other one away.
We got all former.
So this replaces the one that Kim just gave us?
Yeah, what's in your packet is not up to date. And I realize Kim has probably given you three or four in the last 48 hours.
Yep.
And she's been a saint.
Okay.
But trying to reflect up to the minute.
Absolutely. Understood.
So just, while I was sitting here, I noticed a typo that was rather significant. So that's what you have, what I just handed out.
Tricia, would you go through these articles, explain to the board and to the audience and to the TV?
Sure. As I think we've discussed at a few meetings prior, and it's common knowledge, we need to have this town meeting for the really the main purpose of balancing the FY10 budget. And we can talk a little bit in detail about what's driving that, but essentially there's three major components, which are reduction in local aid, significant reduction of local aid, less local receipts than we anticipated. And the other big thing, well, not a big thing, but unanticipated, was we need to fund the cost of the special election to replace Senator Kennedy. So there are a few other increases in the budget, but we can talk about that later. I'm just going to go through the general. And also, I want to thank folks. This is my first town meeting with the town. It's probably my 800th actual writing of a warrant, but each town's a little different. So thanks for all those folks who bared through several reiterations. The second article is for the Waterways Enterprise Fund to match their appropriated budget at year-end to their authorized budget. So there was a reconciliation of $88,000 that we need to take from retained earnings to balance them on the go-forward for FY10. Article 3, the transfer station finished June 30th with a $24,000 deficit. In order to make up for that deficit and ensure that we don't repeat it in FY10, I asked Al to reduce the operating budget for FY10 to mitigate that. The enterprise fund on the authorized budget actually returned $41,000 June 30th, but because it's an enterprise fund, what you're authorized and what you can spend in the shortfall, you need to reconcile. So that's sort of a housekeeping item. Article 4 is a lot of language that simply allows what the town already approved at a prior town meeting to do Rose's Lane. The prior town meeting authorized money for this project. The design work and engineering has been completed. The estimated completion cost is approximately $175,000 more than the original town meeting appropriation several years ago. This is not uncommon, as things take a few years sometimes to be designed and ready to go. Some of this is being funded through the Water Pollution Abatement Trust, so that just gives the board all the same powers and authority they had under the original article several years ago, but increases the authorization for us to go out and borrow by $175,000.
Question? So some of this funding is coming from the water abatement, that's the state?
Yeah.
And then the balance, or another big chunk, is coming from betterments?
Well, we're going to borrow.
We're going to borrow, but then it'll come back on betterments.
Right.
Okay.
So the betterments will include this additional amount as well.
Yes, okay. Thank you.
Do you happen to know how much we borrowed the first time? Mary, do you know that number by any chance? About?
357.
So the project went up considerably, 50%.
Yeah, in part because there was DEP permitting issues that delayed the project like 3 years.
Right. And again, this is all paid for you at home by the users, so it's a betterment to everyone that's hooking up to the sewer will pay for the finance charges of...
Yes, they will pay for the sewer, all costs associated with it, and repaving the street and bringing it back up to standards as was done in all other sewage projects throughout town.
Thank you.
Tricia?
Article 5 is a local option to increase the amount charged to folks when a demand fee charge is levied, and I'm not even going to try to address questions on that, but Jane is here if the board has any questions.
Jane, if you can just tell us in layman's terms, when would a citizen be assessed this fee?
Sure. For real estate, the law allows that I can charge a demand fee after May 1st, so that's only once a year. For excise, we get commitments from the registry of motor vehicles throughout the year. If people don't pay it within the 30-day time period, then we can send demand bills out. Boat excise, and that's all. Personal property, I'm sorry, which runs on the same time frame as the real estate after May 1st.
So you get a tax bill, it's due on May 1st. If you don't pay it by June 1st, you're going to have an extra $15 on your bill.
On excise, yes.
On your excise. Or whatever the other ones you just mentioned as well.
Yeah, well, the real estate is after the four quarterly payments, May 1st is the last quarterly
payment. Right, right. So if you haven't paid your
correct,
real estate taxes in full by the last quarter, then
you'll send them out on May 2nd. Yep.
Oh, just so it's there's not a 30-day...
No, it has to be paid full on May 1st.
So 30 days is on all excise taxes, and real estate is on the day.
Day after.
And is this typical for our surrounding neighborhoods?
I did quite a bit of research on the Mass Collectors and Treasurers website, and some people have gone to the high end, to the 30. Some people have gone to 15, 10. It's really... throughout the state.
But most of our surrounding neighborhoods charge something if you don't pay your taxes on time.
Absolutely, everybody charges something. It has been statutorily $5, and it was an omission in the law back in 2003, the Municipal Relief Act. They increased all the other fees, the deputy fees, the warrant fee, but they forgot to increase the demand fee. That was fixed last summer when they changed this law and gave the opportunity to increase up to $30.
Last question, what do we charge now? Five? All right, so it's going from five to 15.
Correct. And it has to be the same for both excise and real estate. It can't be a difference.
Thank you.
Number 6 is a new article. As I sort of culled through various statutes and town operations, the town has not accepted Chapter 30B, Section 12. Which means that I, as Chief Procurement Officer, can enter into any contract in excess of 3 years, including any extension or renewal. So this is really a housekeeping item that authorizes me to do it for up to 5 years, including any extension and renewal. So for auditing contracts and things like that, we really should have this on the books.
To award contracts, so any contract at all? So if something comes in to do a road or something?
It would be anything that's allowed for the Chief Procurement Officer to approve already, and then there's a threshold, I believe, if it's over 50,000, it has to come to this board. So all those same things
all those
remain,
things stay.
Going from 3 to 5 years.
Okay. And I think it was a 25,000 or 20,000.
That sticks in my head for some reason, 25.
Yeah, 25.
It could be 25.
Yeah. Because it used to be that if it was for engineering, it wouldn't have to come to us, but for various reasons, we made it so anything over 25 has to come to us. But okay, so all that sort of stuff, whatever it may be, still is in there.
Yep.
Okay,
that
great.
That doesn't change. This is just one section of that whole 30B.
Yeah, all right. Wow, that's quite a good thing to have, to add this thing in.
Well, it's sort of housekeeping. I mean, Jane's sort of catching us up, and Kevin's catching us up with it. It's very unusual. You never had a fee for a moratorium or cutting.
Yeah.
So, you know, new eyes, new things.
Yeah, it's good. Thanks.
Trish, when you say renewal or extension, so that allows you to do a five-year extension on a existing contract? Is that what that
five
means?
5 years includes the extension and renewal.
Okay, so you could do a five-year contract.
We could do three plus two now.
Right.
And I don't doubt.
So it's in total, yeah.
Before we vote to support, to put these or not put these on the warrant, one of them is particularly interesting and is going to generate a lot of discussion and thought in future meetings, and that's the article that's going to try to balance the shortfall in this current year's budget. And Tony has been working leading the Finance Committee, looking at this, and Tony, maybe you could explain in general terms what we're trying to do with this article.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, when we projected our forecast, although we brought every one of these items down, they've all went down lower than we initially had thought. So the forecast that we did prior to the annual town meeting, there were additional reductions from the state. New growth is another issue. Local receipts are another issue that seemed to be trending in a direction that's lower than we had initially thought. So Tricia has got together with her departments, and we're going to give it one last look at with the Financial Forecasting Committee to make sure that we're all on the same page, and then come up with some final numbers that will be what the additional deficit will be for the town and for the school. It will be split two-thirds and one-third, as everything is, and then Tricia will come up with her hit list of how she's going to fund her deficit, and then the school department, you know, Bill Johnson's here now, will do the same and have to figure out how they're going to come up with this shortfall as well. I mean, that's the nuts and bolts of it. There's only probably, as Tricia said, less than a half a dozen items that are making this. The largest of them is the cherry sheet number continuing to decrease. Anyone that's read the paper knows that there's a chance that it's going to go down again within the next several months. So the economic situation in our state does not seem to be getting better, and it keeps getting pushed down to the municipalities, and that's why we have to keep having these meetings. Is there anything I'm missing? I mean, the only other thing we'll do is we're looking at expenses to make sure that the assumptions that we made in the forecast initially, that those expenses are online also. And at an initial glance, it looks like it's pretty close, but there'll be a few items that we'll discuss over the next couple of days and get it solidified.
Thank you, Tony. I think it's also worth saying that, you know, this is a work in progress, I guess, over the next couple of weeks to attempt to tweak this as much as we can, and if we can, and try to improve the situation. But unfortunately, it's nothing that comes as any great surprise to any of us. It's been warned by the state. I wish I could say that this was going to be the end of it. I personally don't think it is. We said last spring that this year 2010 is going to be bad, and indeed it is. But nothing's going to happen in 2010 that's going to make 2011 any better. It's just, and this is obvious proof of that. So we're working on it, and we'll do the best we can.
Yeah, I just think it would also be helpful so people know, and I know the newspapers will get this information as well, but we're not talking small changes here. And these figures are fluid, so I'm not going to read them out to the nth detail. But for example, new growth is a little less than $100,000 more than we anticipated. The cherry sheet state aid is approximately $250,000 less than we were anticipating. And there's a bunch of others. And so roughly we're looking at a total difference, if I'm reading this right.
Well, it's several hundred thousand dollars.
Several hundred thousand dollars that we're looking at. So this is not something that's the $19,000 that we can transfer from here to there to solve. It's not $1 million, but it's, you know, several, many hundreds of thousands of dollars that we're going to need to figure out how to deal with.
Bill Johnson, the chairman of the school committee, is here. I don't know if you have any comment or anything you'd like to add. I'm not trying to put you on the spot. I think you...
No, I appreciate Tony and Tricia has met with us, kept us informed of what's going on. Obviously, you know, we know, read the papers and see what's going on. I think we're working with them. to be very transparent on the town side, seeing the numbers, what's changed on the town side, as we are all, you know, the numbers are a town, and we split it, the 66% or 34% split. I think, you know, one, we got to continue to communicate and discuss how we solve the problem. I understand there needs to be something that solves the problem. I think we're struggling a little bit right now is, you know, we really struggled to meet our budget last year, and we had layoffs on the school side, and it took us all summer to go through all the bumping and everything else that goes along with all that. We kind of just got it resettled, and we're going through our reforecasting, and, you know, it's not coming out as exactly what we thought it was coming out, so we already knew we had a gap that we had to solve. So this just kind of goes on top of that gap. And again, we just, the numbers are moving, we can solidify them, but we've already moved into personnel, so it's not like we haven't hit that area yet already. Yeah. So then it will probably continue to be on the personnel side.
Thank you. Scott.
Joe, just a quick question. Was there a reason you didn't mention Article 1?
Oh, I thought I didn't, just in terms of saying that's the reason that we're having the town meeting, because the budget needs to be balanced for FY10. That's what Article 1 does.
Yeah.
I'm sorry if that wasn't clear, Scott.
Okay. As I say, we'll just continue working on it and do the best everyone we can, the school side and the town side. Next, assignment of articles. Historically, the chairman...
I think, do we need to go through and vote each article?
Yeah, we need to vote to assign...
Each article.
Article 1.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to support Article 1 of the special town meeting.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Article 2.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to support Article 2 of the special town meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to support Article 3 of the special town meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to support Article 4 of the special town meeting.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to support Article 5 of the special town meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to support Article 6 of the special town meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That also is unanimous. Thank you. Thank you for pointing that out. The next is the assignment of articles. Historically, the chairman has, on a special town meeting, does the articles. That it's not written in concrete by any means. As of now, for the sake of tonight, why don't I say I'll take the articles. All right, and over the course of the next couple of weeks, I may be asking Tony or someone else on the board who's more familiar with one article or another to jump in and take an article. But for right now, if it's okay, I'll accept all the articles. And we'll
sounds great
there.
To me, Mr. Chair.
All right.
Thank you for that.
Well, don't thank me yet. Yeah, we'll see what happens.
Changing my phone number.
Yeah. Next is the appointments. We have a couple of appointments to make tonight. One to the Waterways Commission was discussed at our last meeting, I believe. And I've seen some information in the paper, et cetera. And Mr. White is here tonight, and we have an opening as an associate member. So
a motion?
A motion.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint Brad White as an associate member of the Waterways Commission.
Second.
Discussion? I think it's interesting. I don't know, just before we vote, I don't know, at least I can't remember, of a non-resident being on a committee before commission. So I think it's exciting, interesting, and probably very beneficial to the town. So.
Yep.
Well, good. Well, I haven't voted yet, but
yep.
Thank you. I look forward to the appointment and serving the waterways that I've recreated in, like everybody else, for 40 years. And
yep.
Look forward to really helping the engine on the team.
We can do that right now, I think. Motion has been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
It's unanimous. Brad, good luck. Thank you.
It'll be fun working with you again, Brad.
Yeah, you bet.
Next.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint Tricia Vincenzi as the town's liaison to the State Ethics Commission.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Was Rick, is this a new thing that we caught that we had to do, or is this?
I'm going to talk about it in my town report, so hold that thought. It's brand new.
Brand new.
You want us to vote on it before you tell us what it is? Has the motion been seconded? If not, I'll second it.
Motion been made and seconded. Discussion? Vote? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? You're it.
May bring that up later, depending on the report.
If one of you would like to do it, it says it's in your official.
Rick?
No?
I think the motion's been made, seconded, and voted on.
Unless the Ethics Commission knows your name, it better.
That's right.
Next is
Proclamation.
Proclamation. Go ahead, Tony, and move the fact that John's not here. Would you take this?
Sure. This is a proclamation. I guess I'll just read it. Or should I?
It's one of the first paragraphs, maybe. Something like that.
Sure. October 24th, 2009 marks the 64th anniversary of the United Nations. Since 1947, every U.S. president, beginning with Harry Truman, has issued a proclamation asking citizens to observe this special occasion. This year's celebration focuses on the topic of developing a global partnership for development, a cornerstone of the Millennium Development Goals.
Thank you.
There is a proclamation before us. Should I read it or should we?
Go ahead. You give it there. It'd be nice. Nice.
Put everyone to sleep. Whereas the United Nations founded in 1945 and the anniversary of the day on which the UN Charter came into force is observed each year on October 24th, and whereas the central role of the United Nations is to promote peace and security, development and human rights around the world, and is vital now more than ever, and whereas in September of 2000, 189 nations, including the United States, agreed upon 8 Millennium Development Goals to meet the needs of the world's poorest, and whereas the 8th Millennium Development Goal seeks to build an international partnership for the development in the world's poorest countries, and whereas the goal calls for all the nations of the world to develop a framework for trade and finance that is open, rule-based, predictable, and non-discriminatory, and whereas the goal further commits developed nations to the principles of the official development assistance and debt relief, and whereas the goal further emphasizes the importance of expanding access to technology, medicines, and jobs, and whereas the United States has shown its commitment to the 8th Millennium Development Goal through foreign aid, progressive trade promises, and generous debt relief measures, and whereas the United States has yet to live up to many of its trade guarantees, provides substantially less foreign aid as a percentage of gross national income than its Western world peers, and must act swiftly to perpetuate the international commitment of debt relief, and whereas the governor's appointed Massachusetts UN Day Chair and local UNA USA members and community leaders will organize events and activities to educate citizens about continuing need for the United Nations and the importance of undertaking efforts on the local and international level to promote global cooperative initiatives towards a more healthy and sustainable world. Whereas the citizens of Scituate are encouraged to participate in the activities related to UN Day, now and therefore we, the Board of Selectmen for the town of Scituate, officially proclaim October 24th, 2009 as United Nations Day. Signed by the 5 Board of Selectmen.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Next, the report from the town administrator.
Thank you. Three items to go over with the board. Two of them are actually sort of heads up, so just to indicate that we're getting out in front of some things. The first item is about the Plymouth County Retirement Assessment. There was a meeting last week of all the member communities that the advisory board invited. There needs to be substantial increases in the retirement incentive for communities over the next several years due in two parts, to investment option losses and also the pulling out of the Plymouth County Sheriff's Department. The increases are very significant, anywhere between $34 million and $60 million that need to be absorbed by the member communities. The refunding schedule was just extended 2 years to address the unfunded liability, and since Plymouth County's was just approved last year, in essence, the county has 2 years before they have to come up with another refunding schedule. That being said, if actual costs were assessed to us based on the actual $60 million, which is the true amount that they estimate now, our retirement assessment would have gone up over 49%.
To what number?
$1,382,241.06.
Wow.
That would have been the increase?
That's the true estimated increase. Obviously, there were over 60 people in this room, and that was not warmly received. The recommendation to the advisory committee, which is non-binding and actually can't even be a vote, was that the advisory committee try to mitigate that as much as possible, because we all know what FY11 is shaping up to be. They took that recommendation and voted to increase rates by 10%. So even though that's somewhat below our minimum exposure, that would have been around 25% at the $34 million. They're going to go with the 10%, again, because they have 2 more years before they have to have the refunding schedule revisited. So
But that's going to happen.
That's going to happen. We're buying some time, because $280,000 increase for FY11 is better than the best case option for us, which was $716,000.
I think that's something we have to keep in mind when
it's going to come up sometime, right?
As we go forward, this things like this is just going to make it more and more difficult for 11, 12, or 13. Just imagine for 1 second if we had to absorb that kind of number. We couldn't do it. I mean, I don't know what we'd do. We'd shut down. It just, the school couldn't absorb it. We couldn't absorb it. No one could absorb it. So,
One of the things is there's legislation pending, and this is an issue of dispute, because the sheriffs are going with the state, and they're taking
right.
the asset, but the liability
in
the department is remaining with the county. That's rather uncommon. A number of counties in the Commonwealth have been abolished, as you know, many in Western Mass, and they went wholesale. It was an issue to take the liabilities when those counties were dissolved. I know that's an issue now that the legislature will be looking at, so we'll probably want our reps and senators to support us and other communities in the county in that endeavor.
I believe we wrote a letter, didn't we, Kim?
Yes.
We've already wrote a letter to that effect, too.
So I don't think that's even been scheduled for hearing with the Public Services Committee, so it needs some agitation, for lack of a better word.
Thank you.
The second thing is something that I've had in other communities that I've served. I don't know if the town here has particularly done it. It's to propose to the board, as I explained in my report, to have a working meeting. And essentially, as it's noted here, a working meeting of the board is duly posted, but no official action is taken. It really just allows you very informally to sit around and have a conversation about town issues, priorities, goals, needs. No official business or appointments or other agenda items are done. I think it might be particularly helpful to contemplate doing something like this. Most of the department heads will be doing a goals and objective-based budget for FY11, so it's always helpful to have that in sync, have the board. There's a zillion things on all our plates, and resources are beyond tight, but I think it's very helpful to take those zillion things and whittle them down to 2 or 3 dozen, and then find out what's important to each board member and see what the 3 to 5 priorities can be in any given year. Some will be short term, some will be long term. That way the departments can therefore develop and align their own departmental goals and needs, not only for what they need to do in their department and to serve their mission, but also in consonance with what the board sees as their long-term. And it helps you allocate resources, because you can then eventually go back and say, we have a strategic plan for this, we've been planning to do this, this is an effective and valid allocation of resources based on that. So I just wanted to toss that out to you. It's nothing you have to schedule imminently. In my experience, they've been on a Saturday morning where, you know, the board talks about what's important to them, what the challenges are, how do we focus, and then we translate those into actual follow-up action items that come to the board and are fully vetted for the review. So that's what that's about. And the third...
I think that's a great idea.
Yeah.
And particularly, you know, having people pull the old master plan off the shelf and start thinking about long-term and short-term priorities, that's desperately needed, and that's great. That's a great way to step towards that.
And again, we can talk about that, as we said, the schedule of the fall, because you're going to be busy as
yeah.
it is.
Yeah.
The last thing is what Tony was asking about, and I believe you have an extensive letter from the State Ethics Commission, and our town clerk, Bernice Brown, will be in an upcoming meeting, but it's really something the board needs to be aware of. It's an additional mandate, for lack of a better word, that municipalities are going to have to comply with. There were broad and sweeping changes to the state conflict of interest law, and they went into effect September 29th. And what the genesis of that is that every single municipal employee, town and school, every member of every board and committee needs to take an online assessment that's on the state website through the State Ethics Commission about the conflict of interest law. And that needs to be completed by December 31st of this year. Like many things passed by the legislature, the law passes and the regulations and the rules sort of come out later. That's the case with this, is that online test actually deals a lot for state employees, and they haven't been able to customize it yet from the municipal level, but they're still requiring you to take the state assessment. It takes about 30 minutes. You'll get a confirmation that you actually took it. There's actually a sort of self-answering quiz on it, and the town clerk is responsible for receiving a copy of that. It has to be done every 2 years, and so it's pretty comprehensive. And as part of that, every community need to name a senior executive person in the community as their liaison to the state, which the board just did earlier. As I note in the report, I had found a need to sort of have more education in the town for the conflict of interest law. I'd already scheduled January 5th, the conflict of interest seminar, for here in Town Hall, which is pretty good, because I think there'll be a long queue now for everybody to get that. And so that will be held here, and folks will be hearing more about that later. But it's a lot of work for the town clerk and for supervisors, because their staff all has to do this training, and boards and committees.
Thank you. Next, other business. Sean, anything?
Yes, I just mentioned to Rick earlier, this past summer, at the Mosser Museum, they held their second Mosser's reunion. And it was brought to my attention about a month or so ago from a resident, Tom Steverman, that what a event it was. And he asked that, you know, I contact Dave Ball and get some information on it, which I have. And I shared this with Rick earlier. And unbeknownst to me, I learned a little bit about mossing. I didn't know. I had never done it growing up. But I'd just like to thank Dave Ball and everything that he does and the entire Historical Society for the wonderful event that they put on. I didn't go, but apparently they're going to do it on a yearly, every summer. So that was it.
Thank you. Rick Murray?
I'm all set.
Tony?
Just another event that we went to that was a great success was the Coors Foundation golf tournament and event afterwards, and the group that put it together did a wonderful job, a great day of golf, and a great auction afterwards. So kudos to that group, and thanks for putting it together.
Thank you. I just want to take a moment to say hello to one of our faithful watchers, Madeline Von Eiderstein, who who watches us faithfully and criticizes when necessary. And I just wanted to say hello to her on behalf of the board. That's it, another business. Correspondence, I don't believe we have any, Kim. Moving right along, the minutes.
Move the minutes of July 15, 2008.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous?
Move the minutes of September 22nd, 2009.
Looking for a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Abstain.
Unanimous? One abstention.
Yeah, I wasn't there that meeting.
Mr. Murray wasn't there. The next item is an executive session. The board's going to go into an executive session to consider the purchase, lease value of real property, and also to discuss labor negotiations. We will not be returning to regular session this evening.
What about the warrant? Do we have to close?
We close it at the end of the meeting.
So at the end of this meeting, it's
done. Yeah, it's done now.
Mr. Murray?
Yes.
Mr. Bagnani?
Yes.
Mr. Norton?
Yes.
Mr. Harris?
Yes.
Thank you all.